Kev here, and welcome back to another video here on the Taco Tech Talk channel. Today, I'm going to be discussing the Tab S7 Plus and giving you my final thoughts and my full review of the tablet. So without further ado, let's get right into it. So let's get the spec right out of the way, because honestly, in this reviews and my channel, I don't really care about the specs. I'm more of a, I want to know what the day-to-day usage is like. So I'm just going to give it to you though, because this is a review and you should probably know, that way you can compare to the monitor you want to get or the monitor you are thinking about getting, you know? So my tablet has 6 gigabytes of RAM, 128 gigabytes of storage. So it is the base model. You can pay about an extra $80, I believe, around that, for 2 extra gigs of RAM and double the storage. In my opinion, that is the better bet, but I'm a broke college student, so I'm gonna save money where I can. Those $80 can go towards my next textbook next semester, something like that. So I'm gonna save money where I can. The display is a 2800 by 12 or 1752, I believe, Super AMOLED display. This thing is sharp, it's beautiful, it's 120 hertz. So simply, it's beautiful and responsive AF, believe it or not. It has two cameras on the back. It has a 13 megapixel primary shooter, and it has a 5 megapixel wide angle shooter. And honestly, they're not the best, but they're also not terrible. They're like, I've seen some people comment saying it's a solid mid-range camera phone, or camera you'd find on a mid-range phone. And I have to agree, it's decent, but not the best. But it's a tablet, so what do you expect? So apart from that, you also get a USB Type-C, and you get a 15-watt charger in the box. These USB Type-C here is capable of 45 watts of charging, but you only get 15 watts. Why doesn't Samsung include a 45 watt or even a 25 watt? I don't know. They're charging a lot of money for the tablet, and they're making you spend more money on a charger. Granted, it's only like, what, 50 bucks, maybe cheaper if you can find it on a deal, but you could have just included it in the box. Same with like the S Pen nibs. I'd heard people used to get them as part of the package. Now you don't. So that's just kind of like, why? Like, come on, stop being cheap, you know? Like, come on. But since you get that 15 watt charger, it's a pain in the ass to charge it, because this contains a 10,090 milliamp hour battery. It's huge. And a 15 watt charger takes around about three hours to charge. And it can be a pain. So definitely consider a 45 watt charging if you need to charge your battery, you know, consistently a lot, or if you're using it a lot. But honestly, the battery has been pretty good. I'm able to get a full day without having any issues. And not to mention, I have to mention this because this is kind of annoying, and it's a trend throughout the whole mobile industry, to be honest. No headphone jack. You're telling me that this huge tablet can't afford to have a headphone jack? Like, okay, this is supposed to be a laptop replacement, right? Most laptops have a headphone jack, right? I hope. I haven't bought one in a long time, and so if they don't, I'm gonna be sad, because like, headphone jacks are so convenient. But yeah, you don't get a headphone jack on this, and it's kind of annoying, but it's the mobile trend nowadays. It's been a trend since Apple did it. So yeah, no headphone jack. But to make up for it, you do get 4 quad speakers, and not gonna lie, they're pretty loud. They're pretty good, they sound nice. They don't have a super bassy sound to it, but they're loud, which is, you know, a good give and take. Not bassy, but they're loud. The Tab S7 Plus also comes with an optical fingerprint sensor. So, along with facial recognition, you get an in-display optical fingerprint sensor. I know the Tab S7 has it on the power button, I believe, but this one has it underneath the display. One thing I want to mention real quick about that is that you can only register 3 different fingers. You used to be able to do 4, but now you can only do 3, and I don't know why. My actually thought about it was because when you have your tablet on landscape mode, which is primarily the way most people might use it with the keyboard attached to it, your right hand is going to be the one closest to the fingerprint sensor. So you can register the thumb and your pointer finger, and you have two of your most common fingers, you know, used to unlock the device. Then your left hand is just left, you know, awkwardly there. So you want to reach across to unlock it? Probably not. So I guess that's why they did it, but honestly, they should have just like kept it simple and just left it at four. I don't know why they added more. It's low-key weird. So that about wraps up most of the specs. Now I want to talk about the performance and the day-to-day usage of how it went. Let's talk about it. The display. This thing is absolutely gorgeous, my dude. Gorgeous. Seriously, it's perfecto. It's gorgeous. The 120Hz makes it so fluid. It's smooth AF. Never thought I needed 120Hz, but I do now. So I need that on my phone eventually. Not now because I can't afford it, but eventually I need 120Hz on my phone. But yeah, it's so smooth. It's so clean. It's quick. It's at least it makes it seem quick and all that because of how responsive the display is. And then the ratio of it, of how the display is, it's like a wider ratio compared to like a 4:3 ratio. It is very nice for watching movies and TV shows. YouTube videos, most videos sometimes are now set to have the aspect ratio of phones, but you'll get black bars, but otherwise that's no big deal. It's better than having a 4:3 display and having those big bars, black bars for movies and shows. At least on this, movies and shows are perfect. They fill up the whole screen. But I do have to mention one issue with the display. The green tint issue. Now, I've seen it on Reddit, I've seen it on, you know, articles. Is it a huge deal? I mean, it is because you paid a lot of money for this, but is it a, like, ruin the experience? No, I don't think it does. You can definitely see it when you're in low brightness, but when you're in normal usage, high brightness during the day, you're not gonna notice it. I think it's just, it's really sad to see that we have to deal with a green tint issue on this, but hopefully they can fix it with a software update, but if they can't, I'm not going to cry about it because I still love the display. I still think it's a great use. I'm not going to complain too much about it. I know, like I said, you pay big money, so you kind of expect nothing but perfection, but you know, not everything is perfect. Also, if you may be wondering if 12.4 inches is too big, personally for me, my huge hands find this tablet amazing for the size. But it might be too big for you. So I would consider going to like Best Buy or any local electronics store and try and see if you can see a demo version of it and then check out the size first and maybe compare it to other tablets around the area because it might be too big for some people. I've seen some people complain about how it's huge. Personally, I think it's perfectly fine, but it's all based on opinion. So I would check out a store if you want to see how big it is. While we're still on the topic of display, I know I already covered it pretty much, but the optical fingerprint sensor, I just want to talk about how reliable it is. I think it's pretty reliable. Also to mention, it works under a tempered glass protector. Currently I have one on and it works perfectly fine. So if you're wondering if you can work or put on a tempered glass screen protector, I think it will work just fine. Another way to unlock your device is using facial recognition. I think this thing is it's not secure, obviously, because it doesn't use a bunch of sensors. It just uses a 2D recognition photo of you, but it still works pretty good. It's perfect for landscape mode. So when you pop up the tablet like this, how I have it now, and then you just open it up with the lock screen, it'll see your face and open up right away. Only issue I've ever had with it is when I'm holding it portrait style and my finger sometimes, or my hand, covers up the camera and it can't see me, so then I have to use the fingerprint, or as soon as I go to try to unlock up the fingerprint, it sees me. But that's the only issue I found with it, but otherwise facial recognition works pretty well, as it does on pretty much I think any other Samsung device that you've ever probably used. Now for performance. How does this perform on the day to day? Simply, this thing is a beast. Even with 6 GB of RAM, this thing can multitask like a champ. Don't think that you need the 8 GB of RAM just to multitask. This thing itself with 6 GB of RAM and the Snapdragon 865 Plus runs like a beast. Even if you, like I may not use this thing to like its full horsepower potential, but I think I use it pretty reasonably like any other user would use it, like your average person. So, here are the things I've done with it. I played some gaming on here and it runs good. So things I've noticed is when I'm running games like Fortnite, I know many people may not play it anymore, but it's a good game to try out considering of how, you know, much it requires of it sometimes. So when I played, there was a few rounds where I put it on 100% 3D resolution and it was struggling to load some of the places. Like, it was like really struggling. It had like these pink areas. I'm assuming it's because it couldn't render them and properly show them on the screen. So it had the pink renderless mountains and stuff like that. It was kind of annoying to see because I was like, why? It was good. But at least it runs at 60 FPS. It doesn't take advantage of the 120 Hertz, but at least it runs 60 FPS, so it makes it kind of smooth. It looks better when you lower the 3D resolution to around 80%. It looks good. And other games run really well too. It's like COD Mobile works pretty well. I was able to play a few matches on there. And Minecraft runs just as well. Looks just as good as it does on the console version. Also to note, I used a Bluetooth wireless controller because honestly, in my opinion, it was uncomfortable to use, just hold a tablet and play games like that. I think I'm much more comfortable using a controller. You can also stream Xbox games on here. I have an Xbox console, so I can just connect it and stream my Xbox and play my Xbox games. I don't have the Game Pass. I know that's probably a better deal, but I already have the console, so might as well stream that instead of paying for the Game Pass. You can get like a bundle deal and get the Game Pass for free for like 3 months or something, but you can do what you can, but the Game Pass is awesome. Only bad thing about it is games run at 720p instead of like 1080 or the 1440p that this display can, you know, run at. So 720p, it's not bad. You know, it's the latency is bad too. It's kind of meh because sometimes when I'm, especially shooter games, it's hard to play shooter games on here because by the time I'm aiming on my sight or I try to look, you know, left or right to get on my target, I lose latency, just lags it up, and then I behind by a second and it causes me to die a bunch of times. Like, I was playing Battlefield and I was dying repeatedly. I was terrible. I couldn't play on here. So yeah, the latency is kind of meh, but it's still awesome that you can play Xbox games on your tablet. I honestly did not even realize that you could do that. I mean, I knew about Game Pass, but I didn't know about the Xbox streaming your console. I thought it was dope that I can play Xbox essentially anywhere in my house now without having to be on the TV, on the living room TV, and use the Xbox there. Now let's talk about the multitasking. Like I mentioned earlier, multitasking is a beast on here. You can run anywhere from 2 to 3 or a bunch of different tabs if you want. I didn't go excessively that much because I'm not gonna be like that person who has a bunch of like tabs everywhere and tiny little spectacles. At most, I think even with how big the display is or considerably how small it is compared to a regular laptop, you primarily will only use 3 apps at a time just because, you know, you want to use the display at a good real estate without having to take some apps might require a bigger screen versus other apps can run small, like, you know, like a quick social media app. But my main usage was being able to use YouTube or watch YouTube while browsing, I don't know, Amazon or browsing Reddit. I like browsing Reddit, so, you know, being able to watch a YouTube video while browsing Reddit on the side is pretty awesome in my opinion. So multitasking is really good. I was able to have a couple apps open while, you know, not worrying about the apps closing on me. Although I do have a tendency to close all my apps right away, so honestly the 6 gigs of RAM is perfect for me. So if you're, like I said, you may not consider the 6 gigs of RAM the best because, you know, $80 more, 2 gigs of RAM more, and double the storage, that seems like a great deal. It is, it really is, honestly. But if you're on the budget and need the base model, you're not gonna struggle at all. Like, it's perfect for me, and it might be perfect for you. But something I want to mention also that I completely skipped on when I was talking about multitasking is you can create your own shortcuts for your like most used like dual pair apps or tri-pair apps, whatever you want to call them, instead of edge panel. So you click on the 3 buttons and it'll, a little plus window, a plus edge panel symbol will pop up and you click on that and it'll automatically create that shortcut on your edge panel, allowing you to quickly get onto your multitasking needs as you please. So if you use like Word or Docs with Google or your Samsung Notes and, I don't know, Chrome at the same time a lot, then you can just create a shortcut so it automatically takes you to that multitasking and sets it up for you in split screen mode, which is really, really cool. We're gonna talk about this issue I came across on as far as the performance. heating. Slight heating. I found it more when it came to using the S Pen, which again I'll get onto later. But the tablet does heat up a little bit on one specific spot. So down by the pin connectors in that general area, or more primarily right above the pin connectors, it seems to heat up a little bit when you're using the S Pen. And it's kind of weird. I don't know why it does that, but it does. And it's not like a heat where, oh my God, you're touching it's burn, but it's just like warm. So, and I just can call it heating issues because, or maybe I should call it warming issues, you know. But it definitely warms up a little bit when you're using the S Pen. And that's something to keep in mind if you're going to be using the S Pen and note-taking a lot and drawing a lot, as a request by, I think it was Mohammed Amid. I'll put the comment right here if I can. But as requested, I took a look at Sketchbook to see if there's a heating issue. And it definitely got warm, but it wasn't like a heat where it was unbearable that you couldn't put your palm on it. It was just warm to the touch. So if you, like I said, might be using this for extensively for drawing and note-taking, that's something to keep in mind because that could be an issue for some people. And, you know, I don't want you buying this and then later going on and realizing that it's overheating on you, because that would be bad. I wouldn't say it's Note 7 level, but it's definitely warm to the touch, unusually warm for some reason. And that's, like I said, something to keep in mind because, like I said earlier, you expect nothing but perfection for the price you're paying. So while I mentioned the S Pen and note taking, what do I think about the S Pen? Honestly, it's so cool. I mean, I'm over exaggerating the fact that it's just a pen. And honestly, I'm not taking advantage of the gestures that comes with it because the gestures are very annoying. But before we get to there, the actual pen itself, it's pretty comfortable. It's nice and big. Only thing I don't like about it is the flat side. I know it's needed to wirelessly charge the pen itself for those stupid gestures, but I wish it was completely rounded like a regular pen, because it would be pretty cool, you know, and become more comfortable. But it's not uncomfortable, it's just you can feel it. Sometimes you get tired of holding it after a while, but again, something to keep in mind when you're using the pen for a long time. So I just wish it was more rounded. But yeah, the gestures, in my opinion, I kind of think they're gimmicky. I mean, you might use them. To me, I'm not going to use them. There's different ones. Like you can try and go back home and then want to like scribble and create a screenshot and screen write. There's one to go back on the previous page of an app. But I just found it annoying sometimes. When I was writing on my notes, I would, you know, you can press the button or hold the button down to switch to eraser mode. And that's how you actually activate the gestures, by holding down the button and then, you know, doing your movement. And so what would happen is I'm writing, I hold the button down to turn it to erase mode, and I go to erase, but then it says, oh, you're holding the pen too close to the screen for gestures. And I'm just like, but I wasn't trying to use a gesture. And it just was annoying to the point where I was like, yeah, I'm not enough. I'm turning it off. So I turn off air gestures. I'm not using them. If you're using them, bully for you, because I'm not going to be using air gestures. Otherwise, I think the S Pen is very good for writing. It's even with the tempered glass, I haven't noticed any type of, you know, interference with the tempered glass. It works perfectly fine, and that's a great thing to note, because if you plan on putting a tempered glass on here, S Pen works just fine. And the S Pen also includes a quick menu on the side that you can access different things for the S Pen. One thing I noticed is actually pretty cool and pretty nice to know is that you can't access the menu if you're pressing it with your own finger. You have to use the S Pen to access the menu and just navigate the menu. You can't scroll, you can't click on any of the quick menu shortcuts. You have to use the pen, and that's kind of cool because it's an S Pen feature. It's literally an S Pen feature. You can't use it without the S Pen, which is pretty cool. Yeah. But let's talk about a little bit about what you do with the cameras and some things I noticed about the cameras. So on the back, you can shoot 4K at 30 frames per second. You can't go at 60 FPS, which, again, I'm not really concerned about that, but that's something to know. You can do 1080 and you can also do 720p. One thing to note, you can't use the ultra wide at 4K. You can only use it on 1080p. I don't know why. I guess it's because it's a 5 megapixel camera for the ultra wide and not 13 megapixel like the main shooter, but that's something to note. Also, the 5 megapixel ultra wide, I think, just goes down in quality when it comes to taking photos compared to the 13 megapixel main shooter. And then the front facing camera records at 1080p as well at 30 fps. You know, it's like a typical, a little better than a typical laptop. I think a typical laptops have like a 720p display or 720p camera, and this comes with a 1080p camera, so they kind of cheaped out and went the typical laptop route, which is okay with me, just because I mean, the only thing I'm gonna use it for if I ever do is Zoom sessions, and you know, that's what it's good for video calls, just Zoom sessions. And now I'm gonna talk about Samsung DeX. Something I like about it is that some apps aren't supported on multitasking on like the tablet mode. You have to use them on full screen mode, or else they just won't open, or you can't, you know, split screen them. On here, you can force them to be used as a regular, you can force them to work on a separate window and have a bunch of windows open, and then boom, you're multitasking like a mother freaking, you know, man on a mission. But yeah, you can just force apps to be in windows, and that's what's pretty convenient about it, because it's laptop, like a laptop-like experience. You have a bunch of windows open and can, you know, set them up to be able to use in split screen mode, or however you want to set it up. But as much as I want to love DeX, I can't seem to stick with it. Like every time I set up the Samsung DeX and I'm using it, I'm always thinking I'm on a tablet, because this is a tablet, you know, and I'm thinking it can do the things that a tablet should do, and that includes, I know this is gonna be probably be some haters in the comments for this, but like gestures and the edge panel, I'm always like trying to use the gestures and trying to open up my edge panel. So I'm like, oh, come on. So I go back to my tablet mode and just do what I do normally. But I think it's a good experience for the most part. There's some things that I do wish that they could do that a laptop can do, just because instinctively you think of doing things like you're on a laptop, but it's not a laptop, so you can't do everything that your Windows laptop can do. So you start to try at least to do things like highlighting text, right-clicking to, you know, go to settings for like Chrome and stuff like that. And it's kind of annoying sometimes, but it's because it's a work in progress, in my opinion. It's still probably not at the top tier what they want it to be, but it's definitely looking very good and promising. It's a multitasking way that you couldn't do before, so it's pretty good. Oh, something I want to note, that when you're using YouTube, whether it be on the Samsung internet or on Google Chrome or the YouTube app itself, you can't have the audio running in the background.
What's up, guys, and welcome to the National iPhone 12 Day.
You think it would work like a laptop, but it doesn't. So if you close any of those three apps that I mentioned that are running YouTube, you won't be able to hear the audio in the background. You have to have the app open on the screen for it to show, or for you to hear the audio. It'll just end up pausing it if you close it out or minimize it. But yeah, Samsung DeX for me is more of a Chrome-like experience than it is a PC and laptop experience. It's just, it's good, but it's not, you know, the best that you can get, because it's not a laptop, it's a tablet, in my opinion. Not to mention, for this being a laptop replacement, you only get one external plug-in, the USB Type-C. If you want to get like a micro SD card, headphone jack, a USB-A, you have to get a dongle, if even a dongle supported. I'm pretty sure it is, just to find the right one, but you have to get a dongle for that, and that's kind of sad. But also, Most laptops nowadays only come with USB Type-C, but at least they come with more than one. But it's just, there's something to keep in note, that is, for a laptop replacement, you only get a USB Type-C. After you're running around using your tablet like crazy, like with Samsung DeX and the multitasking and the gaming, will it keep up all day? I think it does. I think it does. I think the battery is pretty good. If you're not using it like crazy, on it every single hour on the dot, then you're gonna have to recharge every once in a while, maybe once during the day. But I'm using this on the protect battery mode, which is setting your battery at 85% max capacity, and you lose like an additional 15%, so that it can create that longevity of battery life. Will it work? I don't know. We'll have to see long term if it helps my battery not degrade as much. But I'm using that, and even with that on, I'm able to get like 5 or even up to 6 hours screen on time, which I hear is not the best, but it still gets me throughout the whole day without having to plug it in again during, maybe close when I get to that night, I have to plug it in again, but usually I don't have to, which is pretty good. So the battery gets in solid, good plus for me, especially with how much the battery I have to, you know, provide for like the juice draining display, the processor and all that stuff. So I think it's pretty good. I mean, it could definitely be better, but for the most part, it's not bad. So the final verdict, should you buy the Tab S7 Plus? Yes, but it depends. If you want a laptop replaced or your laptop replaced, I wouldn't go with this just because of how limited it can be. You can't code on here, like I mentioned a couple times. I'm a computer science major, so I want to code on my laptop, and I don't have a laptop yet. I use my desktop for that, but that's something that wouldn't work for me because coding is a big deal for me. I want to be able to code on the go, and I can't with this. So if you can, let me know, please, because I would love to know how you can do it. I'm looking for C++ coding, and I don't want to you know, edit text. I want to be able to run the program to, you know, to test it and stuff like that. But yeah, if you're looking for a full-on laptop replacement, this isn't for you. If you're looking for a nice tablet, this is for you. And honestly, this is a good middle ground between a phone and a laptop / desktop, because not only is this good for running Android apps, but it's also good for getting the basics done when it comes to a laptop. It's like typing, getting some Word documents done, you know, watching a Zoom or attending a Zoom session, taking notes. Like, it's just a good middle ground between a laptop and a phone. That's the way I see it. That if you want a solid middle ground, like if you're missing something, like I want something portable, like that I can watch media or then also get some, you know, quick basic work done, this is it. This is the one for you. Anyways, that's been it. Hope you guys took something from this. I'm trying my best to get better at this. I know this video was kind of long too. I just want to get as much out there as I could, you know, to provide info for you guys. And hope you guys enjoy. And if you got something out of this video, leave a like. If you did not like it, I guess you can dislike. I'll try and improve my quality and my review skills. I know I stutter a lot, but that's okay. I'm getting started here. Anyways, thank you guys for watching, and peace out.